Good evening, everybody. Welcome to what we hope is a very meaningful and reverent Maundy Thursday Tenebrae service today. Are there any announcements we need to make other than the ones that we know are coming up with Welsh Cookie Bake and the dining out in May at Texas Roadhouse and the basket raffle? There are details on the bulletin in case anybody wants anything on that. Are there any announcements we would like to bring up tonight? What?
Yes.
No.
But it picks that up a little too loud sometimes, unless I'll speak a little bit louder. Are there joys anybody would like to celebrate today?
We just found out
there'd
be another great grandparent.
Wow! Fantastic. Congratulations. Wow. That's amazing. Wonderful, wonderful. For the umpteenth time. How many times?
Well, it's 22 grands and 17 greats.
Oh my goodness. Yeah. That's fantastic. Congratulations. Are there any prayer concerns that anybody would like to lift up specifically? Yes, Bunny. Okay. Oh,
Judy.
Others too, John.
Prayers for Lori and her family after losing her mom. Thanks.
Charles.
The family of Don Hopkins.
Don Hopkins.
Thank you. Yes.
Others today. All right. Then let's focus our hearts and minds on the worship of God this evening.
Thank you.
things I didn't think of before I left, so I had to write them down. We gather tonight to tell our old, old story. We will tell of bitterness, betrayal, despair, denial, and death. We gather tonight to tell an even older story, prepared before our world even began. This is a story of a powerful love that rewrites our endings with the promise of new life. So we gather to retell the story of our salvation. In the telling of the story, in the breaking of the bread, in the coming of the night, we draw near to Christ again. Please join me in our prayer of adoration and invocation. Holy and mysterious God, as we gather around this table to listen to the story of the Last Supper, we come with ears that prepare to hear, minds prepared to absorb, tongues ready to taste, and hands ready to receive and serve. We come with hearts prepared to love, even to the point of breaking. Draw us closer to you as we receive your love and Christ's grace. Draw us closer to one another to love as you have commanded. We ask these things for the sake of Jesus, our Lord and friend. Amen. And our opening hymn is page 216. Gathered this evening in remembrance of God showing us in no uncertain terms how much trouble he would go to buy us back from the evils that have invaded our world. We also have gathered in recognition of our great need for this wondrous love, knowing that Christ came to save, and not to condemn. Let's join together in our unison prayer of confession, and then silently we'll have an opportunity to open our hearts to God's constructive intervention. Holy and merciful God, your faithfulness to us has been steadfast, yet we cannot seem to have short. We come before you, confessing our sinfulness, out of the hope you yourself gave us. Every time you asked us to stay with you, and we wandered away, forgive us. For every time we fell asleep on the job of being your disciples, forgive us. For every time we boasted of our loyalty, yet crept away, betrayed, or denied you, forgive us. For every time we hear this story and think we could do better than those at your table so long ago, forgive us. God, your love for us is unfathomably deep, and we turn to you to take all our failures and transform us, that we may take the gift of your forgiveness and share it with the world that you made and love so much. Have a right to condemn us? Only Christ, who for us came to live our experiences in human form. For us, he died a grisly death so that he could show us God's power in the resurrection. It is good news indeed. For through his work, our sins have been washed clean and we are renewed to go on again in faith. Thanks be to God. Please join me in prayer for understanding. Holy God, you are with us even when the circumstances are dire, and for that we are grateful. We pray that you will enlighten our hearts and minds as we tell this grim story again, and help us to find reassurance within it. Amen. Our reading for tonight is from the Gospel of John, chapter 13, verses 1 through 17, and 31b through 35, and that will be on page, 876, thank you. Now, before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that this hour had come to depart from this world and to go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, tied a towel around himself. He poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know now what I am doing. Later, you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not only my feet, but also my hands and my head." And Jesus said to him, "One who has bathed does not need to wash, except for the feet, but is entirely clean. And you are clean, though not all of you." For he knew who was to betray him. And for this reason, he said, "Not all of you are clean." After he washed their feet and put on his robe and had returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if your Lord and teacher has washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I've set you an example that you should also do as I have done for you. Very truly, I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are the messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them. Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me. And as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You should also love one another. By this everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." The word of the Lord. When I read scripture, sometimes there's a certain phrase or image that just resonates. I've heard this experience called something shimmers, something sticks out, something sparkles or prickles, and then you know it's a nudge. And Jesus' words, "For I have set for you an example that you should also do as I have done to you," are just such a shimmer and prickle for me. Jesus spent much time teaching his disciples, preaching to them and teaching them, preaching to the crowd, telling parables and other stories, admonishing them when they didn't quite get the concepts he was trying to convey. But in writing, there is an expression, and in storytelling, show, not tell. And I think every writer struggles with how to keep their writing vivid without bonking people over the head with all the telling that they have to say. And I realized that Jesus told with just such precision, so that his actions also spoke as profoundly as his words. I realized that Jesus exhibited God's love for the world and God's intentions for us just as much through all his actions that we've read about in the Gospels as he did his teachings. Healing, feeding people, calming the seas, casting out demons and raising people from the dead. Much of his actions also were very symbolic. What he did, who was involved, where he did it, when he did it, all mattered. There's so much wealth in these examples. And tonight we remember that he was preparing for this imminent betrayal, humiliation, brutality, and death. He continued with tangible examples of what he was trying to get through to the disciples and why. He said, look, I'm trying to show you how this is going to work. The disciples were probably puzzled. The King of Glory, who rode in Jerusalem a few days earlier, now humbling himself to serve them? Peter, of course, was quite confused, at first refusing and then saying, well, then wash my hands and my head and everything. And he would eventually, after Jesus' death and resurrection, finally understand and follow Jesus' way of serving and acting in his master's name. We too, as Christians, are called to follow the example set by Jesus, to serve and love our fellow travelers in this life, and joining together as his body with love and caring, praying for each other, helping each other, encouraging each other, as we do in this congregation. As we prepare to enter into the story and participate in the sacrament of communion, remembering his example of loving and humble service, it's important to remember also that this communion joins us with our triune God our Father, Jesus our brother, and the Holy Spirit who binds us all together. We are lifted through our communion into that great cloud of witnesses, believers from all time, past, present, and future, uniting us into one. How can we but follow not only what Jesus said, but to reach out with love to each other and to all those in need of a gracious gesture? So I invite you all, as we move into the scripture readings of Tenebrae after communion, to relish this special time. Time set apart for sacred and holy remembrance, to remember who has claimed us and has paid the ultimate price for our safety. So let's immerse ourselves into this incredible example that Jesus set for us. What do we each personally recall of him that calls to us, that resonates with us or shimmers or prickles us as we consider what example will we embrace? At this time of year, I think also of the old hymn, I'll Cling to the Old Rugged Cross, and I came across this as I was kind of coming through my study, and I remember getting this. It's a beautiful old rugged cross. It has a carving on it, and it's a girl. She's reaching up over to hold on to the cross, but on the back, you can see she's practically digging her nails into the back of it. And I think that's what we really cling to, though, is Jesus' example. We cling to that as we try to do our best to serve God and one another. I'm going to pass this around. I'll give it to you. And then you can ask to start here. Just pass it around and just kind of look at the interesting details. I ponder this a lot. It's a guiding kind of thing. I thought I'd share it with you. Now we move along to tonight as we listen to our beautiful offertory. Let's focus on that gift of love that we have received in Jesus, who set the example of how to love one another. Amen.
Thank you.
gracious God, you have been so good, bringing us safe thus far. We thank you that we have the ability to share what we have for the work of your church, and may all that is done and said here be to the glory of you, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And as we are standing, let's say what it is we believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Our communion hymn is page 215 or 209? 215.
What wondrous love is this, O my soul, O my soul? What wondrous love is this, O my soul? What wondrous love is
table of the Lord. From the night of his arrest through succeeding generations, Jesus' disciples have continued to come to this table for this holy meal. As he did that night in Jerusalem, so ever since in all times and places, Christ meets us here. We are included in a feast, whether we are willed with faith or emptied by doubt, whether we are first among saints or least among scoundrels, or somewhere in between. In bread broken, cup poured out, we remember the full extent of Christ's love for us in thanks. The significance of this night has been kept by the Church from the earliest years. Tonight, this sacrament is once again handed on to us in our generation. So come, let us join the whole communion of saints as we keep the faith. Please join me in the prayer of late thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us lift up our hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise, O God. It is right, Creator and Ruler of the universe, to give you thanks and praise. You formed the world you called good. In the days of Noah, when humankind had become thoroughly evil in thought and deed, you sent the great flood to destroy all of your name. Yet in mercy you caused the ark to float in safety, and then on dry ground, Noah and his family and living creatures of every kind were brought out to you by you to begin again. And you formed the covenant of the rainbow in the heavens to remind us that you would not do that. Beginning with Abraham, you formed a people of your own. You made a covenant to be their God. And when we were slaves in Egypt, you heard our cries, sending Moses to lead us into freedom. You parted the waters of the sea, leading Israel safely through on dry ground. Though you gave us the promised land and made of us a great nation, we continue to turn from your ways, betray your commands, and yet in love and enduring mercy, you continue to call us back to you through the words of the prophets. So we call out to you now, forever praising your steadfast love and glory. We praise you, joining our voices with choirs of angels and with the faithful from every time and place, who will forever sing to the glory of your name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
You are holy, O God of glory, and blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. He lived among us, teaching and healing, gathering the outcast and the sinner, welcoming everyone into a way of abundant life. By serving, he taught us how to serve. By loving us fully, he gave the example of how we are to love one another. Even on the night of his betrayal, he loved his own to the end. Remembering all your mighty and merciful acts, we take this bread and wine, gifts from the earth, and celebrate the thanksgiving, that saving love of Jesus Christ. Accept, we pray, this offering of thanksgiving as we proclaim the one crucified, risen. Great is the mystery of faith. The fruit of your grace, he was born to offer himself for our salvation and freedom from the power of sin, making us your holy people by his death and resurrection.
Christ has died. Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon this bread and drink, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be for us the communion of the body and blood of Christ. By your Spirit, bind us in love to the Church of every time and place. Loving one another, may we bear witness that we are disciples of Christ and serve others as he served us with their whole bodies, heads, hands, and feet. We give ourselves in humility and gratitude as we await the day that we will share this feast at your table in glory. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, by the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, eternal God, now and forever. Amen. As early as the year 15, Common Era, the Apostle Paul wrote this to the congregation in Corinth. I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. And he said, "This is my body. It is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And after supper, he took the cup also, saying, "This cup is a new covenant. It's in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me." For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim our Lord's death until he comes again. Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Here is bread broken.
Word. Denise. Maria.
Lord.
also raise grateful hearts for the many ways that you bring joy to us, in little and bright ways, as well as in bigger events of our lives. We are grateful for new life, and for great-grandchildren, especially the 17th one that is coming soon. And we so appreciate that we can come together here as your people in freedom to worship you and to love and support one another. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus, our Savior, our perfect expression of love, who taught us how to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
And for reflection is page 218, verses 1, 2, 4, and 5.
During our service of Tenebrae, we will sing a response in between the shadows, and it is the well and familiar tune of Jesus, Remember Me.
Thank you.
and I know you know this tune. And I mentioned that because Jamie is one of our readers, and so she's not going to help us out on that. So we're going to sing it a cappella.
The Shadow of Betrayal, Matthew chapter 26, verses 20 through 25. When it was evening, Jesus took his place with the 12. And while they were eating, he said, "Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me." And they became greatly distressed and began to say to him one after another, "Surely not I, Lord." He answered, "The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man goes as it is written of him, but woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born." Judas, who betrayed him, said, "Surely not I, Rabbi." Jesus replied, "You have said so."
The Shadow of Inner Agony, Matthew 26, verses 36 through 39. Then Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I go there and pray." He took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee and began to be grieved and agitated. Then he said to them, "I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and stay awake with me." And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed, "Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not what I want, but what you want."
Jesus, remember me.
The Shadow of Loneliness, Matthew 26, verses 40 through 45. Then he came to the disciples and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, "So could you not stay awake with me 1 hour? Stay awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." Again he went away for a second time and prayed, "Father, if this cannot pass until I drink it, your will be done." Again he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy, so leaving them again, he went away and prayed for the third time, saying the same words. Then he came to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? See, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us go. Let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand."
Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.
The shadow of desertion, Matthew 26:47-50. While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd with swords and clubs, from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him." At once he came up to Jesus and said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Jesus said to him, "Friend, do what you are here to do." Then they came and laid hand on Jesus and arrested him.
Shadow of accusation, Luke 22:63-71. Now the men who were holding Jesus began to mock him and beat him. They also blindfolded him and kept asking him, "Prophecy, who is that that struck you?" They kept heaping many other insults on him. When day came, the assemblies of elders of the people, both chief priests and scribes, gathered together, and they brought him to their council. They said, "If you are the Messiah, tell us." He replied, "Even if I tell you, you will not believe. And if I question you, you will not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the power of God." All of them asked, "Are you then the Son of God?" He said to them, "You say that I am." Then they said, "What further testimony do we need? We have heard it ourselves from his own lips."
Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.
The shadow of crucifixion, Matthew 27:27-35. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters, and they gathered the whole cohort around them. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on his head. They put a reed in his right hand and knelt before him and mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They spat on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. After mocking him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him. As they went out, they came upon a man from Cyrene, named Simon. They compelled this man to carry his cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull, they offered him wine to drink mixed with gall. But when he tasted it, he would not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his clothes among themselves by casting lots.
Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.
The shadow of death,
Luke 23, verses 44 to 46. It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m, while the sun's light failed, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, crying with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." Having said this, he breathed his last.